So this is our program curriculum. So as you can see here, we'll be starting with Hadoop. We'll understand what are the core components in Hadoop, what is the Hadoop architecture, and within Hadoop there are mainly three things are there. One, the Hadoop storage layer. Second one is the computation layer, which we call as a MapReduce, and next one is the cluster manager. So you know, like Hadoop as a distributed system, it's like a group of systems which we call as a cluster. So in order to coordinate or maintain the resources in this group of systems, we need a one manager service. So that is YARN. So these three are important to understand. So we'll understand all this from the Hadoop architecture point, right? Now when it comes to Hadoop, so these are the HDFS and MapReduce and the YARN. Okay, I can say these are the core components of the Hadoop. On top of Hadoop, there are some ecosystem tools that were developed, something like Hive, something like Pig, something like Hcatalog, something like HBase, something like Ouji, and other stuff, right? Among these services, okay, Hive is the very predominantly used from the Hadoop environment. So Hive is like a data warehousing tool for Hadoop. So in simple terms to say, whatever the data that you are going to store on this Hadoop file system, for the data, if it is a structured data or to some sort of semi-structured data, we can create a tables. Okay, the tables are very much similar to our like the SQL tables, like Oracle or DB2 or any Microsoft tables. We can create on top of the data that is stored on the Hadoop system, and we can query the data. Okay, so whenever you have a structured data, if you are able to represent the data as a rows and columns, it will be easy to query the data. So rather than we sitting and writing a lengthy programs, so that is the advantage with the Hive. And if you already know SQL, it will be very easy to understand the Hive concepts. Even if you don't know SQL, so by the time we cover this Hive, you will be comfortable with SQL and Hive. Okay, so next after Hadoop, we'll take Hive. Okay, once this Hadoop and Hive are completed, then we start with a Python programming language. So already I know some of the students in this batch may already know Python, and some of you guys might have learned Python long back. So just we'll quickly brush up. Okay, so it will help everyone to be in the same pitch, like to revise the Python concepts. Okay, so what is how to set up a Python, what are the data types in Python, operators, flow controls, like functional programming, like how we can define functions, how we can call functions, different ways of calling functions. Then the collection data types. So we have primitive data types and a collection data types, like a list, tuple sets, and dictionary. Okay, these are very important, right? So we'll be looking at them. Then we can see how we can perform IO operations. So reading and writing the files, reading and writing to a console, this kind of stuff. Then we cover some basics of object-oriented features in Python, like what is a class, what is an object, how we can create a class, how we can create an object to the class, inheritance, those kind of stuff. Then we'll focus on exception handling, like catching exceptions, try catch finally, throwing exceptions, look at these kind of stuff. And there will be some other miscellaneous modules will be there in Python. So if you want to work with the time related, if you want to use some time related functions, or if you want to use some date related functions, or you want to use some system related functions, or some mathematics related functions, there are some common libraries that Python itself will provide. Okay, so those we call as a modules. So those, some of the modules we can cover, okay, as a part of this Python programming language. Okay, once Python is done, then we'll start with Spark. And again, with Spark, we understand what is Spark, why Spark. Okay, so what are the advantages of using Spark over Hadoop? What is the architecture of the Spark? What are the main components of the Spark? So what are the different services in Spark we can use, right? Then getting into the details of how we can read a data in Spark, then how many different formats the data will be represented in Spark, right? How we can manipulate the data, like as a general data engineer, like we'll be doing some manipulations on the data. It can be like a data extraction, data mapping, column mapping, dropping the columns, adding the columns, performing some joins, performing some standardizations on the data, right? So treating some null values, like removing some duplicates, like dealing with the different file formats. Like it's like a all the internal to Spark, all the things we'll be covering, right? So again, when it comes to the Spark data representation, so mainly there will be three data abstractions that Spark supports. One is called as an RDD, second one is data frames, another one is data sets. All right. Now, since we are going to learn PySpark, the data frames are the more predominantly used. So the RDD are like a initial version of data representation in Spark, which is not which are not that much predominantly used. But as students, okay, it is required for us to understand how RDD data structures are represented, how data frame structures are represented, how data sets structures are represented, what is the difference between them, what are the different functions are available on top of that. But all this stuff we can see as a part of Spark. Okay, now within Spark, okay, so there is a Spark SQL also. So this is from Spark 2.x onwards, Spark SQL APIs are the predominantly used. Even your data frames, just now I mentioned it, that comes under Spark SQL only. Okay, so how to develop Spark SQL statements, okay, all these things we can do. Okay, then importantly, there are different ways how we can develop our Spark applications. We can use a PySpark interactive shell. So this will be recommended, like when you're a student, if you want to quickly check some functionality of a PySpark, then this will be a easy tool to use or to start with. Okay. And in addition to this, at a real-time project level, the developers will be using different IDEs. IDE means integrated development tools. Like you might have heard about Eclipse, right? Or IntelliJ, or Microsoft Visual Studio, or like that, right? So further, to develop a Python applications or a PySpark applications, we have something like a PyCharm, Spider, Jupyter Notebooks, Zeppelin, or Databricks Notebooks, or IntelliJ, okay? So those things will be covered as a part of this. So which will give like a glimpse of, like in a real time, how we are going to develop the applications, okay? Then Spark executions. So we can run Spark jobs in local mode, client mode, cluster mode. Then we can see Spark UI. So Spark UI will help us to understand how the Spark programs are executed. So how to check the Spark logs, all this stuff will be covered. Then we'll go to another important module of a Spark, which is called as a Spark streaming. So when it comes to data processing, right, like I mentioned in our demo, there are two ways we can process the data. One, in a batch mode, we can process the data. And another one, in a streaming fashion, we can process the data. Streaming fashion means, like as and when the data arrives, immediately we'll do some processing. So when you say streaming, it can be real-time streaming, or to tell even more precisely, it will be near to real-time streaming. So our batch job, like the offline processing, how it happens, right? So from the data source, from the data sources or the production systems, we cannot continuously read the data for our analytical purpose, right? So what we generally do is we'll get this data, let's say daily once, or 24 hours once, or weekly once. Some projects it can happen, we'll get the data monthly once, or six months once, or yearly once, or it can be historical dump of the data. In that cases, we need to process the data in a batch fashion. because we are going to deal with the offline data. But some of the applications require a real-time processing of the data or near to real-time processing. So as and when the data comes, we'll take the data and we can process the data. Okay. So one of the example, let's say computing some moving average. Let's say we have some real-time dashboard, right? Let's say we have some website and we are tracking the traffic on our website. So for a website, what happens, right? There can be like a new visitors coming. There can be like a unknown visitors coming, or there can be like a first time visitors coming, or some different kind of people that will be visiting our websites. So we want to monitor that website with respect to the traffic. So I want to know within intervals of, like say, within every half an hour interval, how many new customers have visited my website, how many existing customers have visited my website, right? So what is the visitors count, right? So for this, like a, let's say back end, we are collecting the data. So we have to, this data is arriving in a real time environment. So as and when the data comes, we need to increment the counts to perform some count of visitors, average number of visitors, average number of new visitors, old visitors, or some kind of stuff. Just an example. So for that, this Spark streaming will be helpful for us. Okay. So those Spark streaming we can focus. So as a part of Spark streaming, right, in our real time, most of the projects will be using something called as an Kafka for the streaming data ingestion. So Kafka is another small framework which can hold the data in a queue. Like some of you might have heard about message queues, like IBM MQ or RabbitMQ kind of stuff. So the Kafka kind of tools, they will isolate or they will disjoin the source and the destination, because source, some like earlier times or traditional things are like the source systems are directly writing data to the targeted systems. But now the targeted systems are varying. There are many targeted systems. So what the source data source provider, he will do, right? He will write the data to the Kafka. It's like a one placeholder of data, like a message queue. Now the targeted system, whoever wants to collect the data, they will read the data from the Kafka. So it makes a decoupling of the source systems and the target systems. So that Kafka will go in detail, like what is Kafka, what is the Kafka architecture, how we can set up Kafka. We can set up Kafka on our local system, we can set up Spark on our local system. All this stuff we will see setting up and working with them, developing our applications. Okay. So next we will see some differences between the Spark versions. So the latest version of Spark is 3.x, so which was released sometime in the June or July of 2020. Or like most of the companies are still using Spark 2.x. So we'll try to understand some of the features on the major versions of Spark, like 1.x, 2.x, and 3.x. So this will be helpful sometimes when you are attending the interviews. Okay. Then we'll move on to AWS. Like AWS, you know, it's like Amazon Web Services. These are the cloud services. Okay. So we will see there are hundreds of services that AWS provide, but all the services are not required for us. Right? So in a big data environment, at least some of the services what we'll be using, those we'll be covering as a part of this. Okay. So I will introduce what is AWS S3, AWS EC2, EMR Glue, Athena, EMR Cluster, and other services. Then we will take Databricks. So I think this was a typo. It is not Azure Databricks. It is a pure Databricks. So a Databricks is like a one of the cloud solution provided by the original developers of the Spark. So a set of people who initially contributed for the Spark development. So they came aside and started a Databricks as a company, and they provided a Databricks notebooks. So where this team is mainly focusing on like a dev, facilitating to run the machine learning models. So now this, once you create a Databricks account, backend we can make data bricks to talk to Azure. That means your data is stored on a Azure cloud or a Microsoft cloud, or your data is stored in a AWS cloud. Okay, we can connect to that one also. Okay, so or we can use the Databricks data file system itself. So like in Hadoop, we have like a HDFS, Hadoop Distributed File System. The Databricks also has a Databricks file system. They call as a DBFS. So we can use the Databricks file system, okay, in our course. Okay, so once we complete this Databricks time, so by this time we'll be more comfortable understanding what is Hadoop, what is Spark, what is this cloud services and all. Then we will concentrate on what is the life cycle of a big data project, what can be roles and responsibilities of a data engineers, okay, with the different experience levels, how you can project your results, then how you can prepare your resume. All these things we will be discussing, okay, and I can walk you through some of the sample projects. So how the architecture of these projects will be, like what technologies they are using, what is the flow they are following, all this stuff you can see. Okay, so with that the course will be concluded. Okay, so now today let's get started with Hadoop. Okay, so this is our first class. We'll start with Hadoop. So let me know if you have any doubts so far. Any doubts so far, guys? Are we good? Understanding this course content?
Excuse me. I just wanted to know. It is completely, big data related thing. But
yes,
what about the Azure data engineering part? Just here. Covering only Databricks. I hope
yeah.
Rest of the topics are there, like data factory, data lake, and rest of the things.
Yeah, correct. So those things will come under Azure data engineering. So that all together is a complete thing. So when you take AWS course, so AWS services will be covered. When you take Azure course, Azure courses will be covered. Azure data engineering, that itself has to be taken as a separate thing. But while this course will going on, like I have mentioned our demo course also, so there will be some of the Azure data services we'll be using, like Azure Data Factory or Azure Blob, Data Lake or HD Insights kind of thing. If some time permits, I will take some extra classes to cover those Azure Cloud also. Okay. Okay, so now at least as per the market, AWS is more being used. After AWS, Azure is used. So if you add up more things, right, it will take a long time to complete our course. But first we'll focus on this, but eventually towards the end of the course, I will try to cover at least some overview of Azure cloud services also. Okay, Ravi?
Yeah, got it. But at least we can understand the topics and Azure data engineering what we need.
Yeah, I will walk through like AWS. I will walk through some services, right? Similarly on Azure also. Okay, I will create account and I will show you like what are the Azure services are there. Okay, and how we can like say if you know one cloud service, learning other cloud service will be relatively much easy. Okay, so those things I will walk through as much as possible. Okay, guys. Any other doubts? And like I mentioned, we'll be having our Power BI classes also, and that Power BI content, like I will share with you guys. Another trainer, Prashant, will be taking. Santosh, I think Santosh will take Power BI. So, or I can ask him also to share the content. So, any doubts so far? Are we good with this? If I have any other expectations from this course also, please let me know. If I try to add to our course, I will try to add. So if the class is more interactive and the people are open to ask their questions and interact, you know, so that gives more interest for me to deliver more. So don't be calm. So feel to talk here. You can unmute yourselves and you can talk. Any doubts so far?
Being a non-native person, can we understand the content what you are explaining?
Yes, Ravi. So you, that's right. You attend a couple of classes. You see whether you are able to understand the concepts or not. Second thing is you need to practice also. For that, you need some infrastructure. So for that, like I mentioned, I will be providing a virtual machine. Like you can see, right? So this is a Cloudera virtual machine. So here, whatever I'm telling theoretically, practicals we can do on this. Okay, and you can set up everything on your local system also. So since this is everything is related to the data, so it will be visible to you. Okay, when I say visible, you read the data and I can show how you are reading the data. When you transform the data, how the data is getting modified. And when you write the data, like we can write the data back to a file system, and you can see the how the data is being written. So since everything is visible to you, you can easily grasp the things. Okay, so rather than if you take some tools and all, those tools back end, they will be doing a lot of work. Okay, that sometimes you may not able to visualize and understand. But with the Hadoop and big data tools and technology, right? So everything will be, you will be easily understanding. Is that fine, Ravi?
Hello?
Yeah, hello, is it?
Yes, Kazi.
Yeah, Kazi, yeah, tell me.
Yeah, so can you use Amazon EC2 to practice, or you have to use a Cloudera?
See, Amazon EC2 is just one single VM instance, right? On top right. of that, yeah, on top of that, again, we need to configure Hadoop.
Right.
Okay. And EC2 instance, if you take, right, it's like a pay as you use model. So it will cost for you. You need to add AWS account and you need to pay for that.
I have the free, well, I think it only limited time you can use, right? So many.
No, but again, even on the free item, there is a T2 Nano, like there are different EC2 instances type, right? Certain instances type only free, comes under free for 720 hours under a free trial account.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
If you take a T2 Nano, it comes with a 1 GB of RAM and I think a 1 GB of hard disk or something. Or even, okay, hard disk can be more, you can get 8 GB or something, but RAM will be very small. So with that 1 GB of RAM, right? So it is difficult to spin up the Hadoop services.
Okay.
So rather than that, if you have your own laptop or office laptop, so configuring this VM system will be easy.
Many things. So how much?
Yeah.
If you have 8 GB RAM, is that enough for?
Yeah, it will be good enough. So you have 8 GB RAM, and again around 20 GB of hard disk space will be enough for this.
Windows 10, should work.
Yeah, you can use Windows 10. Or if you're using a MacBook, there is a Fusion OS so that you can install. On top of that also, you can spin up this VM image.
I have a Windows 10. Should be okay, right? That should.
Yeah, it should be okay.
Oh.
So even if you see, right, even I'm using Windows 10 only.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
So I'm using,
thank
you. So mainly this VM image we'll be using for Hadoop and Hive. And for Spark and all, we'll set up in local system only. It will be easy to configure, and it is good to know how to install and configure also. And everything we can practice in the local system itself. Okay, Kas?
This is Satya. I just wanted to know if there will be any capstone project about.
I didn't get you, Satya. What is that?
I mean, some end of the course. Some real times, you know, projects which we need to implement or something like that.
Yes, sir, that will be there. Okay, already I have a data sets. I will share the data sets. I will give the architecture what needs to be done. Part of the project I will create, and the remaining part of the project you guys have to finish that. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you see, okay, I have some project files. Okay, I need to check. It's going to write something there. I put. So we can use that. This is there, Satya. Okay. Currently, I'm not able to fetch where I have stored. Okay. I'm going to share that one with you. Okay.
Yeah. Sure. Sure.
Yeah. Any other doubts, guys? Are we good? Okay, let's get started with the Hadoop. Okay, so before we start with Hadoop, so we need to understand, okay, some basics. So in the interest of everyone, so I have a people from a non-IT background to IT background, and the people with no experience to like a decade of experience, right? So you have a mixed of audience, but to have everyone in the same like a pitch of understanding, so initial few classes will be little slow, and it will be covering some basics of our computer systems, all these things, but this knowledge will be eventually help you to gradually understand what are the rest of the topics we are going to cover. Okay, so first of all, we'll be understanding, okay, so what is the difference between a single system computing model and distributed system computing model. Distributed system computing model. Okay, now before we start with a single system computing model, distributed system computing model, so what are the elements, okay, in a system, right? So we have like we'll be having a hard disk. Right, on top of this hard disk we'll be having a, okay, let's say operating system will be having, okay, so on top of this we have another hardware like some device drivers or let's say RAM, okay, so RAM, other stuff. So on top of this OS and all, okay, so we are going to have our applications or some system libraries and all. You can say system libraries. So on top of this, we will be having some applications. So this majority of us will know. Okay. So now I am talking about this, right? Now let's assume you have given you one bare empty system. Let's say you purchased a one brand new laptop. So what will be there in this laptop, right? So let's say there will be no OS in that. Okay, so there will be no system libraries in that. So there will be no applications on top of it. So what we'll be having? So we'll be having a hard disk, RAM, ROM, and other things. Right? Now, if you want to use this system, this laptop, okay, you can use this system with the Microsoft Windows OS. Or you can use this system with some Unix OS, let's say Linux or Fedora or Ubuntu or any other thing. Or you can use this system with a Mac OS, right? So we have an option to choose which operating system we are going to use. But before we are going to install an operating system, what we need to do is we need to format the hard disk to a particular file format, to support a file format. So what is there on a hard disk is, okay, on a hard disk, so this serves as your file system. So your file system will be on top of this, or let me put. So you have to format it. Okay. So let's say I'm going to format it. So this is called as a file format. Why? If you are using a Windows operating system, you have to use something like a NTFS 3, NTFS 4, or NTFS 5, some Windows college's own file format, file system format. If you're using Unix file systems, you need to format the hard disk with EXT3, EXT4 kind of a stuff. Right? You can think something like this. Say, I have given a one building with a empty structure. Okay, there are some pillars and roof, some basic things are there. Now, you can use that building as a home, or you can use that building as an office, or you can use that building for some other organization or an hospital or anything else. But when you use that building for a particular purpose, right? So the interiors are going to change. Correct? Same way here, before you install an operating system, we need to, okay, first format the hard disk and choose which file system we are going to use. This you might have noticed sometimes, like even our pen drives also, right, we will format them, right? So if you're using some of the pen drives in a Windows system, and we take and use the pen drives in some Linux systems and Mac systems, sometimes they don't support to write to that pen drive, because the hard disk or the hard disk in that pen drive is formatted with a Windows file format kind of thing, Windows file system format, right? So as such, the file system is very important. The first thing we are going to do is we format the hard disk, okay, based on the operating system we are going to install. We'll format the hard disk. Okay, so now what happens, we'll get a files. Okay, we'll start copying the data. So this hard disk serves as a to persist the data, and the persistent data will be there in the hard disk, and the transient data or the temporary data will be there in the RAM. Okay, now let's say, for example, I have taken one small file. Okay, so let me take like one small square. Okay, so assume that this is my file. So I'm going to write this file to this hard disk. Now, if I want to process this file, how I can process? So in order to read this file, okay, so we need some system libraries, so that OS will be internally using. Okay, so OS will be internally using some system libraries to do that. Okay, so how again we can read and write the data? We can use some applications, based on some applications or tools. So here comes some applications or the tools will come. Now I have stored the data in the hard disk. Now I can process, if I want to process this data, this operating system has to read the data, then only it will process. Now your data here is persisted That means physically it is present. Now the operating system cannot directly read and process the data that is on the disk. So this operating system has to get this data into the memory. So when I say, I think I can just simply put it as a memory. Okay. So when I say memory, it can be like a ROM, RAM, or combination of this, or multiple things can be there. So we need to get the data into the memory, then only we can process it. Now we got some result out of this. Okay, so let's say we got some output out of this. Let's say this is output. Now this output also eventually will be creating. Okay, so assume that this is output I got. Again, it will be there in memory. And if I want to store this output permanently, what I need to write? Again, I need to write it this way, hard disk. So this we all know, right? So now what happens, right? In case like when you are rebooting your system, like you restarted your system. So this data from the memory will go off because we know this RAM is a volatile memory. Once the power supply goes from the system, so whatever the data that is there in the RAM, we are lost. Or when you reboot the system, we lose the data in the RAM. So that's why your RAM is a volatile memory. So that's why we can have only the temporary data or the transient data, okay, in the memory. But in the hard disk, we are going to have the data which is persistent, the physical data. So this we all know, okay. But why I am telling this one, right? Now see, your earlier days we have the systems like this. Even today we have the systems like this. Now over a period of time, okay. So this data is getting increased. The volume of the data is increasing. So when the volume of the data is increasing, right? So if you want to read the same volume of data into memory, right? And processing, all this becomes okay. If you want to load the same data into memory and process, right, these systems are become exhaustive because they don't have enough resources on the system. Okay, so even I forgot to mention here, we'll be having a CPU also, right? So let me put it like that. Okay, we'll be using processor, right? So now, okay, so now within this single system, as your data is increasing, so the resources are not sufficient to load the data into the memory and process them, right? So how you solve this problem? So we need to increase the performance of the system. So how we increase the performance of the system? Increase the resources capacity. How we can increase the resources capacity? Instead of using a single CPU, go and have multiple CPUs, right? We can increase the memory size, we can increase the hard disk size, so we can increase these resources in the system. Okay, so that increasing the resources in the single system is called as vertical scaling. Okay, so increasing resources in a single system here is called as vertical scaling. Okay, so this is a vertical scaling kind of a system. Now, with this vertical scaling, there are again two problems. By increasing the resources in a system, the system performance is coming better, but still it is not reaching the requirements of the big data storage and big data processing. And as we increase the resource in a system, the cost of the system also increases. And just in a real-time environment, we cannot just live with one system. We need to replicate these systems for developers, for QA people, for production, right? And for other purposes. Okay. And another disadvantage with vertical scaling is whenever you want to increase the resources, you need to bring the system down. You have to shut down the system. Let's say I want to add more memory to this system. I want to shut down the system, then only I can add. Or I want to add more CPUs to the system, then I have to shut down the system, then only I can add the CPUs. Or if I want to add a hard disk, that is a hard disk, like some external pluggable hard disk we can add, but some of the hard disks we want to add at enterprise level, right? So again, we need to bring down the system. We have to add the hard disk, do some mountings and other stuff we need to do. So the vertical scaling does not solve the big data problem. So now here, what we are going to do here is to solve the big data problem, we are going with the distributed computing. So in the distributed computing, what we are going to do, right? So rather than relying on the one system to store and process the data, we are going to use, okay, a group of systems. We are going to use a group of systems. Okay, so now these things will be replicated. So we can have any group of systems we can have. Right now, as a combination of systems, okay, so we are going to use them, okay, for storing and processing the data. Now this group of systems, okay, is what we call as a cluster. This group of systems we call as a cluster. It will serve as a like a one unit kind of a thing. Okay, so now assume that this is my cluster. So this is my So now you see, so this becomes like a my cluster. Okay, so now what I can do with this cluster, okay, I'm going to utilize the resources on all these systems rather than relying on the one system. So now if you consider this cluster as a one unit, right, so here we can increase the resources of the cluster. Let's say I want to increase the resource of the cluster. Increasing the resource of the cluster is nothing but adding additional systems to the cluster. So adding additional systems to the cluster. So how we can do that? So again, like so if you want to increase the resources, So I can make add a one system on the plane. So now this is called as horizontal scaling. So increasing the resources in a cluster is called as horizontal scaling. Increasing resources in a cluster, okay, is called as horizontal scaling. Okay, so now when we are dealing with the big data environments, what we need is a horizontally scalable solutions. When I say horizontally scalable solutions, nothing but we need to go for a distributed systems. And what is a distributed system? A distributed system is nothing but a one cluster having multiple systems. A group of systems is called as a cluster. Some people will call this as a nodes. One system people will call as a one node, right? Now, what are the advantage of this horizontal scaling? Right, if I want to increase the resources of my cluster, I can perform that without stopping any of the services. That's one of the big advantage. When you want to do the vertical scaling, right? So within one system, when you are doing the vertical scaling, right? So at that time, what we need to do, right? So we need to stop the services, then only we can do the vertical scaling. But if you want to do horizontal scaling, we no need to stop any of the services. On the fly, we can add systems to the cluster. That is called as horizontal scaling. So that is what we are going to use in the distributed computing model. In a single computing model, we are going to rely on single system. In a distributed computing model, we are going to rely on the multiple systems. Right? Now, okay, so we are going to use the distributed computing systems. Now, how we are going to store the data? That is the first problem. Right? If it is a single system, right, we have one hard disk where we are going to store our data, right? But if it is like a distributed system, sometimes there can be some failures that can happen with the distributed system. In that case, we need to take care how to handle that failures also. So if a single system, when you're in a single system computing model, if a single system fails, the entire system fails, okay? But whereas in a distributed system computing model, if one system fails, okay, still we should be able to process the data. Okay, still we should be able to process the data. So let's say the system got failed. Let me simply say, okay, the system got failed. Even if the system got failed, we should be able to continue with the remaining systems. That is another advantage with the distributed computing. But we have to prepare for such a failure. Okay, in the initial stages, we try to handle the failures at a hardware level. But now we are trying to handle the failures at a software level. That means using software, you are going to handle the failures. The hardware level failures, we have to handle manually, right? Or with some sophisticated hardware systems, we can handle them also. But the failures that can happen in distributed systems, we need to handle them to some software. That software is what we call as some services. that will be running, right? So that we try to understand now, right? So now if you take one single system, so within a single system there will be hard disk will be there, there will be a CPU will be there, memory will be there, operating system, system libraries, some services will be running on top of this, applications tools will be there. Okay, now when you want to go for the distributed computing, what we are going to do, right? We are going to utilize the resources of the multiple systems. So that is the main thing with the distributed computing or horizontal scaling. Now when you go with horizontal scaling, right, so we can perform both. If you go with a cluster, let's say on a Hadoop cluster kind of thing, we can perform both vertical scaling and we can perform both horizontal scaling also. Like if you want to go with a more high sophisticated hard disk under enterprise level hardware, we can go, or we can go with some low cost price hard disks or resource also we can go. Okay, if you take like a 10 laptops, we can combine 10 laptops and we can create one Hadoop cluster, or we can create a Spark cluster with the 10 laptop itself. Or you want to go to some enterprise level hardware, some servers also, okay, with that servers also we can set up a cluster. So that is advantage when you go with the Hadoop. Okay, so any doubt so far? Is everything clear so far? All clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So now, next we will move on to how we are distributely storing the data, right? So when you go to the initial phases, so we have one hard disk and we are storing the data. Okay, so now I have a cluster of systems, like a group of systems, how I can store the data. So that's where we need to understand about the our Hadoop file system. So we'll understand. So what is Hadoop file system as a first part of this? Hadoop file system. Okay, so this Hadoop file system. What happened to this? Just give me. So this Hadoop file system, whatever we have, right, this is called as an distributed file system. So why we call this Hadoop file system as a distributed file system? So now we understand that we are going to use a multiple systems. Okay, so let's say I will take those multiple systems. So this is one system and this is another one. Okay, so let's say so these are the group of systems which are part of our cluster. So now I have a one file. So now initially we'll get this file onto a one system. So let's say this is my file. Now when I write this system to the HDFS, now my HDFS is spread across all these systems, like all the hard disks. So how the data will be written is, right, your file, let's say this file is of 1 GB in size. Okay, 1 GB file. Okay, 1 GB file. This file will be cut down into small chunks or small blocks, and those blocks will be written to the systems. Okay, so let me put that one. So let's see, this is one block. I'll call as a first block. So it has written as a one block. So let's say I got this file as a four blocks. Now let's say these blocks will be randomly written. So the data may go like this. Right? Now, what is the advantage of writing the data here? Means we are distributing it. And whenever you want to process the data, what we can do, right? We can read these individual blocks parallelly and we can process the data, right? So in a single system computing model, when I have my file here and my disk, I need to get this file into the memory, right? And I can here perform a sequential read of data. So reading the data from the hard disk is a sequential. Once we get the data into memory, then we can perform a random read write. But as long as your data is in a hard disk, it is a sequential read. You have to sequentially read the file. Then we need to put into memory, then you can process it. Right? Same thing here. Okay, if I want to process this 1 GB file, which is on a one single system, I can read this file sequentially. So how you process a file? We process a file line by line. So when you open a file, the pointer will be, the cursor will point to the very first line. So we can read first line and do some transformations. Then read the second line, then read the third line, then fourth line, fifth line, like that. So sequentially we can process the files. Okay, sometimes some of the computations we can do parallel. That means rather than taking like a one line at a time and processing, we can take like a 10 lines at a time and process, which will increase our processing speed. So such a kind of transformations, right, we can do parallelly also. Okay, now this 1 GB file, okay, so now this 1 GB file, whatever we have, right, so this will be equivalent to these things. Okay, so now your 1 GB file now is equivalent to a combination of these blocks. Now if you apply some transformation, like I mentioned, right, one by line by line of this 1 GB file, we are going to read and process. But when you want to process the same file, there is a file, it is a content, right, the same file content which is stored on a distributed systems, what you can do, right, whatever the piece of logic we are using to process this 1 GB data, the same piece of logic or the code will send to all these systems. Now on these systems, we can take a block B1 and process. This system take a block B2 and process. This system take a block B3 and process. And this system will take a block B4 and process. So these four systems, they work individually and mutually exclusive of each other, and they process the data. So like I told, right, in our demo, like if one person can do a work in 100 days, if I employ 20 people, in how many days the work can be done? So in 100 divided by 20, in 5 days the work can be done, right? So the 100 days of work we are able to do finish in 5 days with more resources. Same thing happens here. So since we are using the more resources here, right, we are able to perform the parallel computing, or we are going to do the distributed computing. So some people will use the terms like a parallel computing or distributed computing. So rather than parallel computing, we can call this as a distributed computing, like a distributed and a parallel computing. So even in a single system also we can do parallel computing by using a multi-thread concepts. So multi-threading can be used to perform the some parallel computations. Since we are using the multiple systems to process the data, so it is called as a distributed computing. So your 1 GB of file has divided into small blocks and it into the multiple systems. Okay, now this is good. Now the question comes, now where is my HDFS sitting? So if you consider this is an hard disk, like each one, okay, if you consider each one is an hard disk of one system where we are going to store this data, right? These blocks of data, right? Okay, each system from the cluster, it will contribute part of the hard disk to the HDFS. Now when I say where is my HDFS, so I will tell, okay, your HDFS is spread across these systems. So this is what my HDFS is. For the end user, it looks like a single file system only, like in a single system we have like single hard disk, right? So whenever you write a file, like you create a directory and write a file, right? Same thing here, whenever you write a file to the HDFS, will be right. For the end user, this is a Hadoop distributed file system, looks like a single hard disk. I can tell like that, okay? It can looks like a single hard disk for us, but internally your HDFS is sitting on top of hard disks of multiple systems. Now you may ask a question, okay, when you are storing the file in a local hard disk, okay, now in a one system hard disk, okay, whenever you want to read this file, we are able to read this file. How we are able to read this file? Because so there comes something called as an operating system, right? So this operating system the so-called OS, right? So this OS, it will maintain, so the so-called OS will maintain something called as an file tables. The operating system will maintain something called as a file tables. That means what is the file name, what is the file path, okay, who is the owner of this file, what are the permissions on this file, when was this file was first created, right, when was the file is modified, what is the size of the file, what is the file format, what is the extension of the file. Okay, so all this information will be stored in the operating system file tables. Okay, now whenever you store this 1 GB file, right, within one single hard disk, it is not guaranteed sometimes your file will be continuously stored on a hard disk. There can be some interleaving spaces also, because as we write data, delete data, copy, move data, all the activities we are doing on the data set, right? So even when you take a hard disk, they are like a sectors. The sum of the sectors may go as a interleaved sectors. So the data we initially write, after some time some of the data we remove, that means those sectors we erase the data. So then it creates a interleaved gaps under. So whenever you write a data to the hard disk, right, so the operating system will see where is that empty sectors and it will write the data. And the operating system will remember for this 1 GB of file. Okay, let's say that my file name is like a something like a sales underscore 2020.csv. Okay, so which is there under root slash data slash something like a detail data, something like, let's say this is a path. So the file which is stored here, right, will always refer with this path only. We will always refer the file with this path. Okay, internally we are not concerned how the operating system is remembering the location of the file, the file properties, the file ownership details, all those things. Okay, those details will be there in the file tables. So whenever I want to read a file, okay, let's say I'm doing something like a cat, okay, cat slash data slash retail underscore data slash sales underscore 2020.csv. Or you can do anything, right? Let me do like a CMD. I will take a photo desktop. So is there any file here? Okay. Let's say I will do some cat. So some file name. Right. So this is displaying the content of this file. So how this is displaying this some text file? It is there in this location. I might have shut down this time multiple times and restarting. But how this I'm going to I'm able to read this data? Because the operating system knows where this file is physically stored, and it maintains a file table internally. Whenever you are restarting your operating system, this file table contents will be loaded into the RAM, and from there RAM, the operating system will refer that, identify the location of this file physically on the hard disk, then it will read the content and display to the console. That is what is happening. So same way, for the blocks of data we have written, we need to maintain the blocks information. So we have to maintain the block information. So how we can maintain this blocks information? Now say I can take this as a sales for 2020.csv, so which is like a 1 GB in size. I can say one file, so which is 1 GB. Now when you're writing to this HDFS, what happens? So this one file is becoming like a, okay, n number of blocks, became like a n number of blocks. Okay, all these n number of blocks, okay, it becomes like a say, for example, here we take this as a, for example, let's take this as being as a four blocks. So four blocks means it's approximately 250 MB. So 250 MB into four, so again, so which is equivalent to our 1 GB of data only. So now these are four blocks of, where are there, how are these four blocks are there? So these four blocks, okay, are available to us, okay, as these one file is equal to now b1 b2 b3 b4. It's like a four blocks belong, like a constitutes one file now. Now where these blocks are stored, okay, now let me say, so these blocks are stored, b1 is stored, okay, in where, let's I will talk this as a node 1, node 2, node 3, node 4, and a node 5. Okay, so server 1, server 2, or node 1 or system 1, something. So now b1 is there on the node 1, and b2 is there on the node 3, and b is there on the node 4 and B4 is there on the node 5. So we have these blocks available in these nodes. There should be some predefined locations where there is like a block identifier will be there. For each block, there will be an identifier will be there and data will be stored. Okay, so now this drill downs to my sales underscore 2020.csv file is stored as a four blocks B1, B2, B3, which are stored at node 1, node 3, node 4, and node 5. So this information has to be stored somewhere. And where we are going to store the data, how we are going to store that data is what we call as a metadata. The data we call as a metadata, and this data will be stored on a separate system called as a name node. So I'm introducing one new terminology in the Hadoop, which is called as a name node. So what is that name node? So a name node is nothing but a another system. Let's say, so this is the name node. This name node, okay, it manages the metadata of this HDFS. So this is your name node where we are going to have the, okay, it has the metadata. So now what happens whenever I want to read, okay, whenever I want to read data from this HDFS, what I need to do, I need to go with, first I need to contact the name node. So this is the, okay, so this name node I need to contact. Whenever you want to write the data to the hard disk, whenever you are going to write the data to the hard disk, through operating system only we can write the data. If you want to read the data through the operating system only, we can read the data. Same way, when you're writing the data through the operating system only, we can write the data to the disk. Same way, whenever you want to perform any read and write operations to the HDFS, we need to contact name node. Why? Because name node will have the metadata, the information about this file system. So what is the total hard disk space that is we are getting from each individual node? Out of these hard disk spaces, how much of a hard disk space that is allocated to HDFS is free? How much is occupied? Where this file is stored? Okay, how many blocks are there for this file, right? And where these blocks are stored, all of this information will be there with the name node, right? Now, if I want to like write a data to HDFS or read a data to HDFS, how you will do? So we can do it two ways. One, from the command line we can do, otherwise programmatically we can do. So doing programmatically generally is very less use case to do. For that you need to write some Java code or some other stuff, right? But most predominant what we'll be using, right? We'll be using a command line tool for that, right? Now let's say this system is also part of this cluster. Okay, so this system is also a part of this cluster. Okay, so where we have this 1 GB RAM. Okay, but this system, what it's doing, right? It is contributing very less hard disk space or no hard disk space to the HDFS. Right? And this system, let's say I call it as a edge node or a client node, because through this system I'm going to connect to the our HDFS. So in a real-time environment, when I say I have given access to the Hadoop cluster, I will not be given access to the all the nodes in the cluster. All the nodes in the cluster, I will not be given access. I will be given access to the only one node in the cluster. That one node is what we call as an edge node or the client node. So whenever we are getting some data to be processed, stored and processed on the Hadoop. First, we need to get the data into our edge node. From the edge node, we'll copy the data to the HDFS. So how we can write the data from our client node or the edge node to the HDFS means, so there was small utilities tools will be there. So which is called as a Hadoop. I can say Hadoop FS because I'm going to deal with the file system of the Hadoop. So I can say Hadoop FS, let's say hyphen CP. I want to copy the data. So from where? From this local system, right? So I need to mention local LFS path. Okay. And I will mention HDFS path. Okay. HDFS path means, so this HDFS itself, it looks like one individual file system. And all the systems, we have like individual file systems, which we can call as local file system. And the combination of all these hard disks, on top of the combination of all these hard disks, we call as an HDFS, right? So the HDFS also we can consider as one file system. So we have to mention Hadoop FS minus copy, LFS path, and HDFS path. Okay, now when you run this command, what happens?
So edge node will be part of cluster always?
Yes, it will be part of the cluster. Okay, I'll give another representation so that you can better understand that one. So let's say each box here represents a one node, and the group of these nodes we calling as a one cluster. Let's say that is a Hadoop distributed cluster. So now when I given access to this Hadoop cluster, what will happen, right? To one of the node, any one node, that administrator will decide, right? On this system, he will create one user account for Hari, that means myself. And he will create one account for Avinash. He will create one account for Satya. He will create one account for Ravi. He will create one account for Karsh. So the respective developers, using their user ID and password, they will connect to this client. They will connect to this node. And that's why this is called as a client node. This is called as an edge node. So we as a developers will access this cluster through this edge node or the client node. Okay, I will be using board like edge node or client, anything is same. So your administrator will be giving what is the IP address, the IP number of the system or the host name of this system. So you will get a client node host name or client node IP number and the user ID and password. And you can connect. So once you can connect, so you can perform storing, storing the data, retrieving the data, or running some jobs on the cluster. So how we can do that? So we can do that using this Hadoop command. We can do that. So you can say Hadoop FS minus Hadoop, like Hadoop FS minus copy. Okay, I can say copy from local. I can mention the LFS path. LFS path means this is a local path on this edge node, and the HDFS path. So the HDFS also we have to, we can create a directory. Like in the local file system will create a directory, on the HDFS system also we can create the directory. Now let's say Hadoop FS minus mkdir. Okay, I can do like a slash HDFS slash my project. Slash data slash retail underscore data. So assume that this is the path. So I can create one directory like this, Hadoop FS minus mkdir slash HDFS slash my underscore project slash data slash retail underscore data. Right? So now this file, let's say on the local file system, is on a slash data retail data sales underscore 2020.csv. Right, so now you want to copy this data. So this command I can use Hadoop FS minus copy from local, or you can use minus put also, or you can use move from local. So these very few commands will be there that you can get to know in couple of minutes. So Hadoop fs minus put. Okay, so here what I need to use, this is my local file system, right? This is a file path on my local file system. I'll do this, and this is a file path on my HDFS. Okay, so for us the HDFS looks like a single file system. That's why we can have a directories created, okay, all those things, and you have files under this, right? So when you want to read the data back, so if I want to read this data back, right, so I can do something like a Hadoop fs minus cat if you want to display the content of the file, or I can use minus get if you want to get the file locally, and you can use this path. Okay, and here I need to mention, let's say sales underscore 2020 dot csv. So you also sales underscore 2020 dot csv. So here what happens, right? As soon as you run this command, right, Hadoop fs minus put source file and the destination file path, this Hadoop is a one shell script that was developed by the Hadoop people itself. So internally this Hadoop will invoke a one client program, a Java program. That program will first go and call this name node, contact the name node, okay, and it tells, so there is a file in this location on this local system and I want to copy to the HDFS. Then this HDFS client, what it will do, right, it will break down this file into small blocks, b1 b2 b3 q4 like that, and it will copy those small blocks into the different systems. Okay, now that information of this file as a multiple blocks is available in the metadata. So the writer, once is written the data to this one, it will go and update the metadata saying this, so for this file, these are the blocks, these locations, these are updated, these are modified. Okay, so such information will be maintained. Now I have written the data to the HDFS. Now I want to read the data back. If I want to read the data back, what I can use, I can use some command like a Hadoop fs minus get, and here first we need to mention the HDFS path. Then you have to mention the local path. Let's say I want to copy the data to some temp location. Then I can say Hadoop fs minus get, okay, your HDFS path and the local path. Now, when we run anything, something like this, right? In this case, what happened, right? When you want reading the data back, Hadoop fs minus get data, we are reading the data, or Hadoop fs minus cat data, right? At that time, what happens, right? The request will go to the name node, and the client will ask, I want to read the data, so which is there in this location? Right, which is there in the location. Now the name node will look into this metadata, see what are the blocks for this data, which like B1, B2, B3, and where they are available, and these IP numbers, it will be given to the client. Now the client will directly read the blocks from the individual blocks which are stored on the multiple systems. So this is how we can write and read the data from the HDFS. But everything will be like a completely runs in the background. We know not to bother. Right? Now this is good. Storing the data in a distributed way, like it helps us to read the data parallelly and compute the and apply our computations parallelly. But there can be some failures that can happen with the distributed file systems. Now when I have copied this file, okay, so what will happen if one of this file has one of the system has gone down? Okay, so let's say okay, let's say this node 4 went down. Now the system is not available because of some power failure or some network issue or something. Now when I'm reading this data, what will happen? Now the block 3 is not available to me. Right? I simply put like okay, let's say now say this block 3 is not available for me. Now this is a good way of storing the data in a distributed fashion like this. So whenever I'm processing the data, I'm reading this file. So block 1, block 2, block 4 I got. So block 3 is not available. So then how you are going to deal with this situation? So one thing we need to keep in mind, right? So when you're working with a distributed system, sir, failures are expected. We are supposed to handle those failures. So how we can handle those failures? So one way we can handle these failures is, okay, we can have a backup of this data. So we can have a backup of this data. Again, where you can have a backup of this? In one of these nodes only. Let's say I will take this block. Okay, I will have one copy in this system. Okay, and I have another copy in another system. So now what happened? This B3, the block 3 is available in the node 2, node 4, and the node 5 also. Or let's say anyway it can be, let's say I have it here. Right now this is like a copy of that one, so I can give this as another color so that we can understand. Let's say I will give one copy and this is like another copy of that. So now B3 is replicated twice. Is that only B3 that is replicated twice? No, the B1 also will be replicated. Okay, so there is a copy of B1 in node 1, node 5, and node 4 and node 5 also. Okay, now the same thing with B2. Okay, so you have a copy of B2. In a node 3, node 4, and node 5. And B4. So we have a copy of B4 like this. So like this, the data will be returned to the HDFS with duplication. That duplication is what we call as a replication factor. So the blocks are duplicated. So I can write the HDFS file blocks are duplicated. Duplicated means like we have a multiple copies. Okay, and these multiple copies is what we call as a replicas. We call them as a replicas. And how many times each block is replicated, that is called as a, we use a term called as a replication factor. Replication factor. So we use, so I introduce another term called as a replication factor. So we have something called as a replication factor. So there will be one setting. So we can make the replication factor as a one, minimum one, right? Minus zero, minus one, minus two does not make sense. So we have replication factor as a one, R two, R three, R four, R five. So the advantage of this replication factor is, okay, even when the system goes down, okay, so the blocks which are stored on this node, the same content can be read from the another system also. Okay, now see, if the node 4 goes down, if you want to read the block 3, okay, so still node 4, since node 4 is not available, I can still get this block 3 either by reading node 2 or by reading node 1. So from either node 1 or node 2, I'm going to get the block 3 that is available, right? So now how your file looks like now? So now your one file is like a three, it was divided as a four blocks, right? So now again here what happens, each block, okay, now it's a B1. So now B1 is stored in node 1 and node 4 and node 5. So B1 is there in node 1, node 4 and node 5. Similarly, B2, block 2 will be there on, okay, will be there in node 3, comma, block 2, B2 is in node 3, node 4, you should have this given somewhere, right? Okay, this answer, node 4 and node 5. Node 4 and node 5. And similarly, rest of the blocks also, you can have it. So this is what becomes the metadata of the name node. And again, we no need to bother about it at all. Hadoop as a framework, internally it will take care. But it's good for us to understand how the distributed storage will happen, right? So now what happens, right, when a client wants to read this data, let's say it wants to read this data, right? So when I want to read this data, okay, so here what happens when you do Hadoop fs minus get, that means get means get this data from HDFS to the local temp location, okay, the request will go to the name node. The name node will give the metadata. So saying that where each block of information is available. Now let's say the client got to know that block B3 is available in node 4, okay, and node 1 and node 2. It will try to reach the node 4, but node 5 is not reachable. So then it will go to one of these nodes, let's say node 1, and from the node 1, it will get this block B3 update. So even though there are failures in the Hadoop distributed file system, those failures we are trying to handle by replicating the data. Right? All these things can internally happen to the Hadoop file system. But now we can ask another question. So what happens, okay, when you're writing the data to the HDFS, let's say if you're writing this 1 GB of data, since we are going to have, okay, three blocks of this data because of a replication factor, correct? So we are having this data as a replication factor. So now 1 GB of data now becomes a 3 GB. Okay, is it acceptable? Yes, still it is acceptable because we have to sacrifice for the hard disk space in order to make the data highly available. So for high availability of the data and to handle the failures of the data nodes, so these nodes are called the data nodes, we are going for the replication factor. So by the time 1 GB of data is written to the HDFS, it becomes a 3 GB. Is that okay? Yes, this is okay, because my high availability of data is important than my hard disk space. Again, nowadays the hard disks are very cheap, so that storage cost of the data is less because the hard disk need become cheaper, so we don't need to bother for that one. So that's why, so whenever we store the data on HDFS kind of a system, the data will be stored in a distributed way with in a replicated fashion. So the Hadoop file system is called as a block structured file system. So it is called as a block structured file system. Block structured file system. So why is it called as a block structured file system? Whatever the data we are writing to the HDFS, those data will be written as a blocks. So that way is called as a block structured file system. Right now, knowing all these things, internals of this, so how difficult or easy for me to work with the HDFS? It's very simple. What we need to do is, suppose assume that this is your edge node. Okay, just we should know what are the Hadoop commands that are available. I can say Hadoop FS. Okay, so when I say Hadoop FS, so this is giving the options. Hadoop FS. Right, we can use append to file, cat, checksum, change group, change mode, change owner, copy from local or copy to local, right, count how many files are there in a path, or cp within HDFS to HDFS you want to copy the data, we use minus cp command. Or if you want to copy the data from local system to the HDFS, we have to use a copy from local. Or you want to copy the data from HDFS to local system, then you have to use copy to local. Then similarly, we have like a DF and DU, which will give the disk usage, how much of a disk they are using on the HDFS. Then expunge I will tell a little later. Then get command, so this is to get the data from the source, which is like HDFS, to the local destination, right? So or if you want to list the files on the HDFS, just you can use a ls command. You want to create a directory, just you can use a mkdir. Or you want to move from local, so you want to move the data from local system to the your HDFS, and you can say move from local. Move to local, so move to local means it will copy the data from HDFS to the local system. So what is the difference between copy and move? So with the copy, when you say copy from local, after copying the data, I will have the data in my local system and I will have the data in HDFS also. But when I say move from local, whatever my data is there in the local system will be written to the HDFS. After that write operation is done, my local file will be deleted. So that is the difference between the copy from local and move from local. And similarly, we can use the mv command, move command. This is to move the data within HDFS from one location to another location. Or we can use a put command. So this is again to copy the data from local system to the HDFS. Or we can have a rm. If you want to remove a file, we can use rm. Or if you want to create a directory, we can use rmdir. Or you want to select the access controls, we can say set access control, set attr, we can set them. Hyphen stats will give the statistics. Then hyphen text, hyphen touch usage, all these things. So these are the only limited set of commands we have with the HDFS. So there is nothing more than that. If you are comfortable with the Linux, like whenever we have used some commands, right? The same commands we can use here: ls, mkdir, okay, move, put, rm, rmdir. All these are like a Linux commands only. Okay, let's say on my Windows I have my Linux command support, so I can do something called as an ls. Next to ls, it is listing the files here, right? Okay. Similarly, now say this is my local system. So this is my edge node, right? For edge node, generally we will connect with PuTTY. I will show that later. So assume that this is my edge node. So on my edge node, I can do ls. So this is giving some files. So these are the files on my local file system of the edge node. right? Now when I do like a Hadoop fs minus ls slash, so this is giving what are the files directories under the root directory. So in the root directory I have something called dbs, hari, hbase, hm data, lookup data, og, solar, test, temp under. Now when I give the same thing ls slash, okay, this gives what are the files under the root directory of the edge node. So this is my edge node, right? So under the root directory of my system, this local edge node, so these are the files are there. See the difference between ls slash and Hadoop fs minus ls slash. Okay, so this is something brief about the HDFS. So any doubts so far? Are we good so far? Yes, any doubts? Is it clear?
Ari, one question. See, we are dividing it to blocks, right? Who does that job actually?
So here, whenever we are performing this operation, right? Hadoop command. Okay. This Hadoop command is a shell script. Internally, it will go and invoke one client Java program. That Java program will cut down the files. Okay, like we have a replication factor, right? There is something like a Hadoop DFS dot block size. So there are some parameters will be there in the Hadoop configurations. Based on that block size, what are we set? Okay, so you asked a good question. So there is something like a DFS dot block size. Okay, this will be set to, let's say, 64 MB. Okay, or 128 MB. I will tell again on tomorrow class why 68 MB or 128 MB. So actually, this we will mention in bytes, not like MB. Okay, in some X bytes we will mention. Now the client program will read this property. And based on this property, whatever the file we have given, if the file is greater than this size, it will chop down the files into that blocks. Okay, let's say you have written a 1 GB file. Okay, now and say your block size is, each block size is 64 MB, for example. Then what happens, it becomes like a 1024 MB, okay, divided by 64 MB. So we will get somewhere around, I think it is 5.6, okay, let me do some quick math, I'm doing mathematics. Okay, 16 blocks. So this we are going to, this we are going to get as a 16 blocks. 1 GB file will be written as a 16 blocks. So how that will be done? So let me show you. So now say which Hadoop. So Hadoop is a script. Okay. So this is referring this from here. User bin. This one. And when I say file and this one, this will tell, this is like a shell script. Okay, since it is a shell script, I can go and cat this file. So I can display the content of this file. So if you see this one, this file is internally, okay, setting some Java home, and it is calling another file executing another file called user lib Hadoop bin Hadoop. So this another script this is executing internally. Okay, good. Control shift C. Now when I say file, this one, this will be again a shell script, again executable shell script, bash script. Now let's go and see the content of that. So cat.
Yeah.
API. So when you do cat right on this file, so this is how the shell script is running. So initially it will be like if you give wrong usage, it will give this usage. Then it will check the environment, all these things, blah blah blah. So there will be one jar file internally. So it will be invoking that one. So exec java, java heap max, Hadoop options, dollar class, dollar at the rate. So this dollar class and all. So if you look somewhere, this is like a command what we have given. So it will take this command and internally. So to put it simply, internally it will call some Java code. That Java code it will invoke. Okay. So So if you look at this Hadoop, right? Hadoop is completely written in Java. The Hadoop as a framework, right? But if you want to write the data, if you want to use a Java code every time, it will be like a tedious thing. So that's why they introduced something called as a Hadoop CLI. So whatever we are using, this is called as a Hadoop CLI. So this Hadoop CLI, okay, is nothing but a shell script. We call it as a Hadoop CLI. CLI means command line tool, command line interface. This Hadoop shell script internally invokes some Java code and it will take care. And again, as a end users, we no need to bother about. Is that clear? So who asked this question? I think Satya, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Is it clear, Satya, no?
Yes. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. So all these are like a wrappers. So for the end users, they are like a masking all these things. Guys, you don't bother about all this internal heavy writing. Okay. As a end user, okay, as a, let's say I'm as a Hadoop developer, I'm providing a simple utility. So which that utility we call as a Hadoop. Right? You just use this Hadoop utility. So with this shell script, right? So this asking, it has a further options called Hadoop FS, version, jar, check native, distcp, archive, class path, credential, demo log, class name. Okay, so run the class name what we have mentioned. So now here I can say Hadoop and I can give FS. So run a generic file system user client. So internally it is going to invoke the file system user client, which is a file system user client. HDFS file system user client is going to use. Now let's say Hadoop FS. Now when you say Hadoop FS, right? So these are the further options for the Hadoop FS we have. So Hadoop FS and generic options, those are like append to file, cat, like a ls, copy, all these things. Now say here, in this system, my Hadoop services are up and running. I can do Hadoop FS minus ls, okay, slash. So it's like a root directory, Hadoop has. So in Hadoop root directory, I have a directories like this, right? So now let me go inside Hari. So Hadoop FS slash ls slash Hari. So inside this, there is some data. Okay, let me go inside data. Okay, so if you see, so there is something like a cricket scores. Okay, so let me go under this cricket scores. So in a real time also, we have to remember this path or we have to navigate like this. So under this file, okay, you can see there is a some text file is there. Now see the difference. If I just to do ls, it says no such file or directory. Because when I give ls, it is looking in the local file system. And when I look, when I use Hadoop FS minus ls, it is looking on the HDFS file system. So now you may ask, okay, where is your cluster, Hari? You are connected to the system, where is this cluster? So now what this VM system is like, it is like a one node cluster. So when I say cluster, I can have a one node in it, two nodes in it, three nodes in it, four nodes or 4,000 nodes also. Initially, when Yahoo was experimenting with Hadoop, they set up a Hadoop cluster with 4,000 nodes. That means 4,000 individual systems, they collected as a one group and they ran their Hadoop jobs on a 4,000 node cluster. Just imagine. Right? So now what this VM system will work as a, this will work like a one node cluster. So on this one node cluster, how this metadata is there? Where is this metadata? Where are all these being stored means? So for this, right? So there will be services will be there. So those services will be running. So back end, if you see, right, so the Hadoop services will be running. I can do sudo JPS. I will go to these things later. So there is something like a name node. So I told no. So there is something called as a name node we have. So this is a name node. So this system is behaving like a name node. And there are other systems where the data is being stored. So these systems we call as a data nodes, right? So for this, there will be one process. So where you can see there is a data node process running. So like this, there will be multiple process running. We can see all these, what are these process, what are the services, we'll understand in the next upcoming classes. Okay, so we have this, that's all for today. So you have any doubts, feel free to ask. Otherwise, like tomorrow we can connect, and step by step, slowly we can go inside, we'll understand things. Okay, so now just to mention lastly, nowadays many people are using cloud services, right? So in cloud we'll be using something called AWS. So there will be AWS as a file system. That file system, AWS file system, is what we call as a S3 file system. Okay, this is like a simple storage, AWS simple storage service. Okay, if it is like Azure, okay, which is a Microsoft also has a file system. Okay, so that file system is called as a like a blob storage, BLOB, blob storage, blob store or blob storage, or they have something like a data lake also, right? And Google Cloud Computing, GCP. So GPC also has a file system. So whatever your email data, all these things, right, we'll call as a so-called Google Drive. Your Google Drive is nothing but your Google file system only. So this call as a Google Cloud Storage, so GCS, right? And all these systems of cloud, right, these are also distributed. So this is a AWS distributed file system is S3. Azure's distributed file system is blob storage or data lake. And for a Google file system, right, so the distributed file system for Google is Google Cloud Storage. Okay, so this is also called as a this is like a Google Cloud Storage. And what we are calling on Hadoop, so Hadoop also has a distributed file system, okay, which we call as a HDFS. FS means file system, DFS means distributed file system, HDFS means Hadoop distributed file system. Okay, is it clear, guys? Any doubt so far? Any doubt so far? All are good. Kaj, Malikarjun, Ramesh, Ramu.
Yeah. Hmm? Yeah, we are good.
Okay. Feel free to like interrupt me and ask doubts, like in case you are not getting it. Okay. So yes, like I mentioned, right? Yeah. So these are first two few classes. No, this will be a little slow, but these things are very, very important. So once you understand these fundamentals, right? So rest of the things, okay, it will be easy. But when it comes to the real time, what we'll be using, like I mentioned, right? So we'll be using this Hadoop commands only. But in the interview, what they ask, so they will ask some questions like this. Okay, how HDFS is highly available system? What is the replication factor? So what is the difficult replication factor? Okay, how do you copy data from local system to HDFS? How do you get the data from HDFS to local system? So these will be some of the interview questions they will ask. So at that time, we need to mention, like, these are the Hadoop FS commands we can use. The default replication factor is 3. So why the data is replicated means, for high availability, we like to handle the failures, we are having the replication factor set. Okay, all this stuff. So where is what is a name node? So name node will store the metadata. So once we complete this HDFS topic in detail tomorrow, then we'll see some interview questions that we can get on the HDFS. So this is like a very introduction session. Tomorrow we'll see a little bit more details of the HDFS, right? How the read operation will happen, how the write operation will happen, what are the HDFS shell comments are there. Okay, I will show that. And like we have like some couple of classes for free, right? Once the registration is done, so what I will do is I will give access to that VM player. This VM player, I put it in my Google Drive. So you can just, I can given the like instructions also. So let me show you if possible now itself. Okay, so this is a VM player, and this is like a actual VM image, and this is like a 7-zip extractor, and these are the steps I have given. So just you can follow these steps, okay, and you can install. I will give you access to this system, like this is a Google Drive. You can just download it and you can set it up. It's like a very simple thing you can. And once you do, like I will show you like. If you are not earlier worked with VM players, it will be very simple. So we need to install VM player. It will come like this. So if you have an image, right, you can have an image name there. Just select this one and then just click on this power on. Okay. So when you power on, right, what will happen, right? You will get your. Okay, I had one, right? Okay, you will get a window like this. Then you can right click, you can take a terminal and you can work here, or you can get an IP name, IP of this. You can use a PuTTY also, and using PuTTY also you can connect. I will show you how in real time we can connect in cloud, how you can connect all these things one by one. I will show you. Okay, so that's all for today, guys. Any doubts so far, feel free to ask. And if you have any feedback also give me, like is it good if you go with this speed, or the way I'm delivering the content, all these things you are able to get, or if you want any like if you're not comfortable on any other stuff, let me know accordingly. If possible, I will accommodate the changes. Any doubts so far? Any other doubts for today? All good. Okay, then we can wind up for today. Okay.
Yeah.
Mahesh. Yeah. Thank you, guys. Thanks, Ramu.
Yeah. Mahesh, thanks.
Thanks, Ajit. Mahesh, you can stop recording, Mahesh.